Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming. Sorry that it took so long to start. For those of you who are in my class, especially the MBA class, you need to sign, when you leave, sign that sheet out there that I know you came. So sign your name and also put which class you're in. So if you're not in the MBA class, you get extra credit. If you're in the MBA class, you actually get credit. Otherwise, you lose credit. So thank you for coming to the University of San Francisco today. I'd like to thank the Dean of the Business School, Elizabeth Davis, and the Associate Dean of the Business School, Barry Doyle, for making these great events possible at the University of San Francisco. Also, I'd like to thank Margot Fry and her team, Noonie Byrne and the film crew, and many other people. I would also like to thank Valerie Gonzalez for making everything happen so easily. Before we begin, I kindly ask you to turn off your cell phones in an attempt to keep quiet so others can hear our guest speaker. If you have questions for the guest speaker today, please write them down on an index card. We have index cards going around. Students are handing them out, so you can write your question down on an index card, and then the students will collect them and hand them to me for the Q&A. The plan is to have 1 hour of one-hour talk on Bitcoin, and then we'll take a five-minute break, and then we'll do a Q&A session, including audience questions. If you like tweeting, you can also tweet and make sure you put hashtag USFSOM so that we get that done too. Our guest speaker obtained his undergraduate degree at Vassar College. He majored in sociology. During his undergraduate studies, he read an article about the Bitcoin, and he became fascinated. He spent all of his time learning about the Bitcoin and eventually wrote an undergraduate thesis about distributed encrypted networks and how that would affect our society. With a wonderful thesis and a fresh college degree, he set his sights on chasing the American dream. But the Bitcoin job offers didn't come piling up on his doorstep. Instead, he moved to Washington State and became a lumberjack. His day consisted of using chainsaws to cut down trees. Then one day, he was approached by a couple of guys who wanted to start a company to transact the Bitcoin. He took the opportunity. He is now head of risk at Coinbase, the largest Bitcoin company in the world. He protects Coinbase customers from malicious activity and fraud. Today, our guest speaker will speak about Bitcoin. He will cover everything so that you will finally understand what the Bitcoin is. He will also talk about what Coinbase does, and finally, he'll speak to students about entrepreneurial opportunity. Please give a warm welcome for Olaf Carlson-Wee.
Okay, awesome. Thank you for having me today, Ludwig. So Bitcoin, I'm sure you've all heard of it at this point. 2 years ago, I wonder how many of you had heard of it. So I have a quick question, just so I can gauge the audience a little bit. How many of you own Bitcoin? Oh, just a couple hands, okay. Oh wow, I had a couple follow-ups on how you use Bitcoin, but I'm just gonna skip those, okay. As Ludwig said, I got into Bitcoin in about mid-2011. I became obsessed right away. So about a week after I found out about Bitcoin, I was wiring most of my life savings, which was meager at the time, being a poor, indebted undergraduate student, to Japan, where the only exchange really existed, Mt. Gox, who we now know will live in infamy for losing almost $500 million. I got into Bitcoin pretty quickly and pretty deeply. Once I started thinking about it, I really couldn't stop. It was kind of a rabbit hole. For me. I hope to kind of open that rabbit hole for some of you today. I think Bitcoin is one of these topics that's excruciatingly difficult to really wrap your mind around, but once you understand it and understand the potential, maybe like me, you will realize that it's the most important idea you've ever heard, at least in my lifetime. I want to first talk about a couple ways people think about Bitcoin that I think are incorrect. First of all, people often compare Bitcoin to existing technologies. People compare Bitcoin to credit cards and say, how is it different? How will it replace credit cards? People compare Bitcoin to US or other fiat currencies and ask, you know, how will it replace them? Will it replace them? How is it better? How is it worse? I think these are all the wrong questions. This is because any new serious technological breakthrough cannot be compared to the existing world and existing technologies. It has to be compared, you know, basically to itself, its own parameters, and see what, and so everyone can see what is possible with it. So today, I feel like Bitcoin, take away any comparisons you have between Bitcoin and existing technologies. Think about Bitcoin as a truly novel technology, and you need to understand it for what it is and what it's capable of. Because most of what is important about Bitcoin is creating things that cannot exist today. It's not simply improving the efficiency of some things that already do exist, such as payments, which is generally the number one way Bitcoin is being used today. I think I want to kind of go over an overview of the Bitcoin space, where we're at. How has Bitcoin come along in 5 years since it was created by an anonymous person using the pseudonym Satoshi Nakamoto? So then I want to cover what Bitcoin is and how it works, how it's being used in the world today, what Coinbase does, and how we fit into the Bitcoin ecosystem, and then talk a little bit for the future entrepreneurs in the room about opportunities in the Bitcoin space and what this is going to look like in the next 1 to 3 to 5 years. And then I think I want to get really crazy and talk about the really long-term future of what is possible with Bitcoin and the blockchain. Okay, great. So this is a graph of the number of Bitcoin transactions per day since the creation of Bitcoin in 2009, January 3rd. So as you can see, it's going up. At this point, we have about 100,000 Bitcoin transactions today, or about 1 per second, which it seems like a lot. But at the same time, when you think about large-scale existing payment networks like ACH, Automated Clearinghouse, which is the bank transfer protocol, or you look at credit card networks like Visa or MasterCard, they're processing an order of magnitude more than one transaction a second. We're talking closer to maybe 500 transactions a second or more, especially when you look on a global scale. Most existing payment mechanisms completely dwarf Bitcoin in both the amount of volume that they're moving and the number of transactions that are happening. So Bitcoin's growing. Okay, but it's still extremely obscure on the world payment space. Why do so many people care about Bitcoin? Why are they talking about it when it's still so small? So I think it's important to think about Bitcoin as something that is still extremely nascent, even though it has gotten a lot of attention in the media, maybe has attention in headlines and somewhat sensationalized for the things like Mt. Gox and Silk Road. I think it's important to step back and really think about where Bitcoin is going. So look at the trend, don't look at the past, and see what Bitcoin has done. Because you can never really find an opportunity after it happened, right? You need to be looking into the future rather than the past. So I want to emphasize Bitcoin is not a mainstream technology, and it won't be mainstream anytime soon. I think a lot of people get excited about Bitcoin in the next 6 or 12 months replacing the dollar. This is an absurd idea. So just want to clarify where I stand on that and the misconceptions that kind of exist in the media. Again, I want you to throw most of what you've heard about Bitcoin out the window so we can talk about it from square one. Okay, so this is my second relevant graph. So this is venture investment in millions of dollars in Bitcoin companies since 2012, when the first venture investment happened. So as you can see, a total of over $600 million has poured into Bitcoin companies since venture capitalists and certain technologists found out about Bitcoin and started building things with it. So all of Bitcoin combined, the whole market cap is about $5 billion. That's not very much. I mean, a lot of very large public companies are worth significantly more than that, orders of magnitude more than that. And the venture capital investments in this space are over 1/10 of the entire market cap of Bitcoin, which seems like a pretty extreme ratio. So why are venture capitalists so excited about Bitcoin? Why are so many people throwing millions and millions and millions of dollars into Bitcoin companies when they're really not building anything anyone's used? I mean, I saw about 3 or 4 hands go up saying that people had used Bitcoin. So why are people so excited about Bitcoin? And why is venture capital putting their money where their mouth is, so to speak, and actually dumping millions and millions of dollars into Bitcoin? So again, I want you to think more of Bitcoin as a trend and a future potential rather than a story that we can already look back on. The story is being told right now. Okay, so first things first, since not many of you own Bitcoin, I'm guessing many of you do not have a great understanding of how Bitcoin works. So I'm going to go over some of its core characteristics and some of the things that really make Bitcoin a unique technological protocol that's unlike anything we've seen before. So first, it's open source. What does this mean? It means that Bitcoin is on github.com. Anyone can go and look at the Bitcoin code. Anyone can actually add to the Bitcoin code. Your additions won't necessarily be included in the core protocol, but you can request that they are. What this means is that thousands of security researchers around the world can audit Bitcoin's core code, core protocol, and anyone can really look at how it works. So I have a second question for you. How many of you know how the Fed works? Where is their white paper, right? Where is their open source protocol for how money is printed? It's much more complicated than that, right? So with Bitcoin, while it's very technologically complicated, in a way there is a beautiful simplicity in the fact that anyone can go look at exactly how a Bitcoin transaction works and where Bitcoin comes from and, you know, exactly what they're using, down to the byte code, right? So the second piece of this is open access, right? Bitcoin is a completely open payment mechanism. What this means is anyone can participate. So I can open a Bitcoin wallet and start transacting Bitcoin immediately from my computer or mobile phone. If I want to open a bank account, it doesn't work like that. I need to go to a bank. I need to verify my identity with that bank. I might need to have some sort of credit history. I might need to have a minimum balance, things like that. In general, when you participate in mainstream payment mechanisms, such as credit card or automated clearinghouse payments in the United States or worldwide, things like wire transfers or even going down to mobile carrier billing or things like that. At the end of the day, you basically need to make a deal with a third party, such as a bank, in order to make sure that you can receive payments and participate in the global economy. With Bitcoin, anyone can receive a Bitcoin payment and anyone can instantly start participating in the economy. There's a second piece to this open access that I want to emphasize, which is that anyone can create their own blockchain. So a blockchain is a decentralized ledger of all payments in the Bitcoin network. This keeps track of every Bitcoin transaction and is a sort of public database that anyone can write data to. So whenever I want to do a Bitcoin transaction, I write code, I write history into the blockchain that will never be erased. This is true for anyone participating in the Bitcoin network. So Bitcoin is one of many cryptocurrencies, and the beauty of this is that anyone can create their own cryptocurrency and launch it. So there's an amazing amount of competition between these various crypto protocols. It doesn't work like this with normal payment mechanisms or dollars or fiat currencies. So to launch my own credit card network, there are all sorts of legal requirements and huge infrastructural costs in order to do that. In order to launch my own currency, I generally need to found my own country, which is obviously pretty difficult. So with Bitcoin, anyone can go and create their own blockchain. It's pretty beautiful because there are thousands of people around the world who are releasing new blockchains every day with new characteristics. Most of them you've never heard of, most of them I've never even heard of, but we're talking about maybe one new blockchain a day. I mean, it's pretty amazing the pace of the innovation here. And some of these blockchains have very, very different characteristics than Bitcoin. I'll get into the details of that later, but it's important to note basically that the innovation is completely permissionless. This is what I mean by open access. Anyone can create their own network. Okay, so piece two on here is P2P, peer-to-peer. Okay, so this basically means that anyone can send Bitcoin to anyone else in the world. Okay, so I want you to let that sink in for a second, because it's actually a bigger idea than you might think. So right now, if I wanted to send a dollar to China, how would I do that? Okay, the real answer is that I can't do that without paying maybe $30 or $50 or $100 to send the $1. Okay, with Bitcoin, I can send a tenth of a penny to China. It will get there instantly, and there's no in-between party or middleman who's going to process that payment. The payment is going to arrive instantly on the other side, and I can transact with anyone in the world this way, and they can transact with me. So no one has to have a bank account. No one has to, go through any sort of verification of their identity to participate in the global economy. Anyone can receive a payment from anyone in the world. So the third thing I want to cover here is that it's programmatic. How many of you know what an API is? Okay, so this is an automated programming interface. So what it means is it's a kind of way to interact with some code. I'll leave it broad like that. Okay, so what it means is Bitcoin is kind of an API for money. So what this means is I can build computer programs that interact with Bitcoin in a very automated and efficient fashion. There's no API for the Visa credit card network, right? I can't just go and start building all sorts of cool applications that involve payments on top of this, again, in a permissionless way. Of course, companies make deals with Visa or get verified by Visa to accept credit card payments, but at the end of the day, there's all sorts of hoops you have to jump through, and the permission is with a centralized party. With Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies, you can freely write any sort of code to participate in the economy. What this means is, again, there's permissionless innovation to write any sort of payment code on top of the existing protocol. We'll get back to what some of that might look like later. Okay, so the fourth thing here, fast, cheap, and global payments. So this is kind of related, obviously, to the peer-to-peer idea here. And this is where most of the real-life applications are happening today. So basically, with Bitcoin, I can send money all around the world, and it's free, and it's instant. Okay. So right now, when you send a wire to a different country, it actually goes through a number of different banks, and it takes a while to clear. When I send a bank transfer to another person in the United States, it takes about 2 or 3 days to clear. This is the automated clearinghouse system. It was never meant to be consumer-facing, and it was created in the 60s and 70s, as were credit card networks. So when you're thinking about, what does it mean to have a free, open, global, and instant payment network, it's very powerful. But again, there are very, very difficult network effects to get around. So the reason credit cards are useful is because we all have them and merchants all accept them, right? With Bitcoin, apparently only 3 of you have it, and no one accepts it other than a few obscure online retailers, right? Well, that's changing, I guess. They're getting more and more mainstream. But for this global payment network to operate, there are huge network effects that need to be overcome. This is going to happen over the next 5 or 10 years, in my opinion. But this is, again, where most of the innovation is happening today. So this is where a lot of people are finding efficiencies with Bitcoin for cross-border payments, micropayments, online payments, things like that. I'll get more into that later. Okay, so the second to last thing here, money equals bytes. And what I mean by this is, normally what's a dollar, right? So it's either a good old greenback, something I have in my wallet, or it's a digit in my bank account. So with Bitcoin, I can store money any way that I would store zeros or ones, okay? So you can store Bitcoin on a piece of paper, you can store Bitcoin on a computer, on a mobile phone, you can store Bitcoin as a password in your brain, okay? So you can consider what the implications there are for capital controls worldwide, right? Anyway, the point is you can store Bitcoin any way that you can store a string of ones and zeros. Very, very different than the way money is stored today. And so the price, so a lot of talk about the price in Bitcoin, right? Was at a dollar, went up to $1,000, now it's about $250. A lot of people got rich, a lot of people lost money. It's very exotic. To me, it's not. To me, it's just Forex markets playing out and getting mature. So. The price is determined by the quality of Forex markets in Bitcoin. So right now, there's not really advanced trading features. Things like derivatives, options, futures, forwards don't really exist in the Bitcoin ecosystem. Primarily, you can basically buy it or you can sell it. What this means is there's not a lot of liquidity. It's not hooked into most large-scale kind of trading desks. So the types of people that would be trading on traditional Forex markets, like for pesos and dollars and yen, aren't really trading Bitcoin. What this means is there's not a lot of liquidity and not a lot of trading tools. So the price is incredibly volatile. On top of that, it's a very speculative asset because people are excited about it. So this all leads to a very volatile price, getting less volatile, but over time, still, still definitely volatile, but will be going down over time because as these Forex markets mature, the Bitcoin price will kind of mature. So I want to talk about the photo on the right there. This is an actual graph of Bitcoin transactions in the network. So each one of those nodes is an address. The larger nodes have received a lot of payments, the smaller nodes not so much. So this is kind of what the Bitcoin network might look like visualized. Again, this is a tiny, tiny piece of the network, and consider that a transaction is happening about once a second. So this kind of graph has probably been created since I started talking. Okay, so how it works. This is very complicated. So this is the part of Bitcoin that a lot of people get caught up on. And it's the part of Bitcoin that down the line, 99.9% of people won't know, but they'll still be using Bitcoin, okay? So I don't, most of you probably don't know how the automated clearinghouse protocol works. It's kind of a crazy protocol. I interact with it every day. But you still use it, right? You've sent a bank transfer. When you use all sorts of payment apps like Apple Pay or Google Wallet, you're participating in these huge payment networks that were built over decades, but you don't know how they work. And there's a very, very good reason for that. They're extremely complicated. Again, excruciatingly complicated. But again, a lot of these other payment networks were completely unaffected by the internet. So pretty much every industry, when the internet was created, it completely transformed that industry. Payments is one of the rare industries that was basically completely unaffected. When you pay with credit cards online, that's essentially a hack on top of what was meant to be a point of sale mechanism, which is why this insane idea of identity theft exists today, right? So if I just memorize a few digits, I can actually have your full identity. Okay, so, but I am going to delve into how it works. If you have really technical questions, ask me afterwards, after the whole presentation, perhaps. Okay, so it's a global network of computers. This is important to understand. Anyone can turn on a computer and participate in the Bitcoin network. Okay, these are called miners. So to mine Bitcoin, essentially your computer is contributing processing power towards verifying transactions in the distributed ledger of the Bitcoin network. Okay, it's a little bit of a mouthful. But basically, your computer is on and it's really hot and its fans are going like crazy. Okay, and it is processing a whole lot of hashes. I won't get into too much detail here, but basically, you are, as a miner, verifying transactions in the network. The moment someone broadcasts a transaction, it's distributed to all the various nodes in the network pretty much instantly. So this is the real-time ledger updates are possible because these miners are all communicating in real time. Again, that ledger of all transactions, the history of all transactions that's being updated in real time constantly, is called the blockchain. So you'll hear me say blockchain a lot. Just make sure you know what that is. So this global network of computers is basically building a blockchain at all times. And the blockchain may one day become, the Bitcoin blockchain, I should specify, may one day become the most important database ever seen, essentially. So this is a public database that, again, anyone can write data to. There are transaction fees on the network. These are extremely small, so maybe about a penny to send a transaction. This is both to prevent spam and so that it costs money to write data to this database because everyone needs to have a full copy of this database in order to mine Bitcoin. So this database gets larger every single day. It's something like 25 gigabytes right now. Someday this database will be orders of magnitude larger than that. So processing these Bitcoin transactions is getting to be big business also. If you look on the right at these photos, this is kind of Bitcoin mining through what I might call 2012, 13, and 14. Okay, so you have 2012 at the top. This is like a guy, you can see his DVDs. underneath his little Bitcoin miner. So, you know, he's mining some Bitcoin, but, you know, these days that wouldn't, you'd be losing money on the power to mine that Bitcoin. So this is how the Bitcoin network started, right? There were maybe 1,000 people around the world with this kind of rig in their living room mining Bitcoin. And this is actually how the network was bootstrapped into existence. It's just a whole lot of people mining Bitcoin. As things got a little bit more advanced, you can see in the second photo, so this guy's dedicated a pretty large room of his house to a very, very intricate network of Bitcoin mining machines. So at this point, something called the Activity-Specific Integrated Circuit, ASIC, was created. This is a chip designed specifically to mine Bitcoin. So the ASIC chip can't do anything else. Before the ASIC chip was invented, people were mostly using gaming graphics cards to mine Bitcoin because they were pretty good at it. Chip is about 50 times more efficient. So pretty much everyone moved to ASIC, and now you can really only mine Bitcoin with these ASIC chips. And so then you can see in the bottom, this is a huge warehouse. I don't know if it's hard for you guys to see, but there are about 20 rows of, you know, I don't know, what looks like maybe 200 individual ASIC mining machines per row in an enormous warehouse. So this is what Bitcoin mining is today. Bitcoin mining is a huge business, and people around the world are searching for the cheapest power there is. A lot of these are in Eastern Washington, where I was actually doing some of this lumber work, because the power is incredibly cheap there. So the network has changed a lot. Mining has centralized to an extent, but the power of the network is that it will stay distributed. So while mining gets centralized since, you know, the conception of the protocol, I think over time, it will reach a kind of stasis where there's the right amount of decentralization that keeps the network secure, but also centralizes because, like many things in business, it scales. Okay, so talking about this point three, the larger network. So as mining has gotten bigger, as you can see on the right, a bigger deal, more computers, everything, this makes the network more secure. What it means is that there are more machines validating transactions more quickly, communicating those transactions to the network more quickly. It makes it harder and harder and harder to attack the Bitcoin network with your computing processing power, as long as there is more and more hashing power in the network. So basically, as the network has grown, the number of computers contributing to the network has grown exponentially. This is one of the things in Bitcoin that really hasn't slowed down at all, is just the number of computers contributing to the network. So as that grows, the network gets more and more secure. So it's a great thing for everyone. All transactions verified through cryptography. I'm not going to get into how that works. And so why do people mine, right? So it's this incentive-based system. So like I said, every single transaction, there's about a one penny fee. Right now, that's the minority of why people mine. The real thing is what's called a block reward. So every 10 minutes, the ledger is updated and finalized. So during that 10 minutes, it can kind of be up in the air. And this is mostly based on network connectivity. So various nodes not being as connected as they should. But every 10 minutes, a new block comes around that basically puts the blockchain in stone, right? So you can never change the history of the blockchain. So every 10 minutes, 25 new Bitcoin are created. This amount will go down every 4 years with the Bitcoin protocol. So in 2017, this will be 12.5 Bitcoin. In 2021, it'll be 6.25 Bitcoin, et cetera, et cetera. At some point, transaction fees will become very important for incentivizing miners. Right now, transaction fees are the minority, and these block rewards, these chunks of 25 Bitcoin, are by far the lion's share of why miners are contributing to the network so they can earn this new Bitcoin. So yeah, mining, again, if you don't really get this, that's fine. Like I said, no one understands how credit cards work, and they still work, right? So this is the part of Bitcoin that I think a lot of people and journalists get caught up on, is trying to understand how it works. Frankly, if you don't understand cryptography and computer networking, this is very, very complicated. It's kind of like explaining how the internet works. We can all use Google, but we don't all have to have degrees in computer networking to understand how the internet works. So a large goal of Coinbase's, and I'll get to this in a little bit, is to abstract this mess of wires and this cryptography away from the end user so they can gain the benefits, but we can kind of obscure the complexity of the network. So how is Bitcoin used today? So I really want to emphasize with this that these are ways that Bitcoin is being used right now. So as in, you know, these one transaction a second, what's actually happening there? So one of the first big killer use cases has been micropayments. So, you know, why does a song on iTunes cost 99 cents? You know, it might seem like a good price, might be reasonable, I don't know, but why can't I stream a song for a penny? Anyone know the answer to that? The answer is that it costs 30 cents plus 2.9% to charge a credit card, right? So I'd be paying about 34 cents, and Apple would be receiving about 1 cent of that 34 cents every single time we charge a credit card. So you really can't pay for things online that cost less than a dollar, which is weird, right? I mean, you know, the internet has all sorts of opportunities for micro content or paywalls or things like that where you run into this payment barrier and you really can't charge less than a dollar. One of the big ways that micropayments in Bitcoin has been manifested is tipping. So with this big circular logo with the dollar sign in the hat, this is a company called ChangeTip. So what they're doing is really interesting. They basically allow people on forums to tip other users for their content or some of their comments, right? So these users don't know who each other are, but they can still pay money to each other, even though they might be on different continents, and they might be just sending 10 cents or $10, it doesn't matter. They can all contribute to this global payment economy just based on the content of these people online. So you can imagine this expanding to the point where the entire internet's content could be monetized through these peer-to-peer types of donations. Things like YouTube right now are basically fueled by advertising. So are many other websites. You could imagine a future where instead of advertising, this is all built on micropayments. So this could be very, very, very tiny payments. We're talking, you know, a hundredth of a penny for one packet, kind of. Another way it's being used right now is peer-to-peer loans and crowdfunding. So it's kind of two different things, I suppose. The peer-to-peer loans, so if you see that BTC Jam, this is a really interesting company. They allow anyone to take a loan from anyone else in the world. It's a completely peer-to-peer marketplace for loans. So BTC Jam is only kind of there to allow people to meet other people, so to speak. But BTC Jam is not necessary for these payments to occur. So the real infrastructure there of the loan is not built by BTC Jam. It's built by the Bitcoin network, which again, totally open, anyone has access to. So all of a sudden, you know, people on a different continent, maybe in the second or third world, without access to mainstream American payment technologies, can all of a sudden receive loans from people in America. So what we've seen is, you know, microfinancing in Africa, for example, is just starting to discover Bitcoin. And it's because a lot of the payment difficulties with contributing from to a cause on a different continent is through the payment infrastructure. That's why it's hard. And with Bitcoin, it offers this peer-to-peer payment infrastructure so that anyone can get a loan from anyone else in the world in a free and open marketplace. It's pretty amazing, and it's growing, but again, it's very obscure. But in the future, you could imagine a whole system of where the entire world's kind of loans are coming from crowdfunded and peer-to-peer payments. Just think about that for a second. So the other one is crowdfunding, so Kickstarter, right? They take 10%. They can also deny things from entering their platform. If they don't like what you're raising money in your crowdfund for, they can kick you off. So this top company, Lighthouse, at the top there, they're not so much a company as they are software. So you download Lighthouse software on your computer, and you can participate in these decentralized crowdfunding campaigns. So I can say, you know, I'm going to release this product and everyone pay me a dollar and contribute to my campaign. I could finance a company this way, right? So I could get donations from anyone in the world to finance my company. And it's completely decentralized. So the possibilities here are really limitless. And again, there's no centralized control, so no one can really say what is a valid reason for crowdfunding, and anyone can participate as long as they have an internet connection. Okay, so cross-border payments. This BitPesa at the bottom, they're a company, a remittance company in Kenya that's processing Bitcoin payments to facilitate cross-border payments. So again, right now, a pretty big hole in our payment infrastructure is cross-border. So the internet is completely global, increasingly our economies are becoming totally global, but the payment infrastructure is based on states. And it's hard to cross those state lines without incurring some sort of fees or problems or currency conversion or Forex or something. So you can imagine a future where a lot of these payment infrastructures that are cross-border, remittances, for example, are all done in Bitcoin, or rather using the Bitcoin payment rail even if the end user doesn't know it. Okay, asset storage and transfer. So storage.io that you can see in the lower right corner, they're really offering broadly a decentralized Dropbox. So any sort of peer-to-peer network right now is essentially altruistic. There's, to use the terminology in torrents, there's seeds and there's leechers. So I can contribute to the network and I can take from the network. In the torrent protocol, this means offering files up and people downloading files. In the Tor network, this means offering a bridge connection or using that bridge connection for internet traffic and bandwidth. So what storage is offering is a sort of decentralized Dropbox where I can contribute a part of my computer in an encrypted fashion to store your files for you, and then you pay me directly, okay? So instead of paying Dropbox to store all these files, we just can pay each other to store these files, and there's no middleman taking a little bit of cut, i.e. Dropbox's profit. So you can imagine, again, sorry, you know, I keep thinking about the future with all these. I was meant to stay in the present, but it's really too exciting for me to not look 2 or 3 or 5 years in the future. So, you know, in the future for me, a lot of the centralized services that are taking a cut are basically going to be decentralized, encrypted, and no one's going to be taking a cut. So it's going to be peer-to-peer and very, very efficient as far as pricing. So merchant processing. This is a big one that's got really, really big in 2014. So a number of very, very large companies accept Bitcoin for payments right along credit cards. Companies like Dell, Overstock, Expedia, you know, Microsoft, a lot of pretty big companies have started accepting Bitcoin at this point. It's a little bit less exciting for me because it's essentially something credit cards already do. And for most people, it's not an enabler of something they couldn't previously do. It's kind of a nice to have thing. It's not a need to have, right? So if I can only remit money home through Bitcoin, that's going to be very, very important for me. But if I can do it through some other mechanism, it's not so important. So for me, what I care about are these so-called native Bitcoin apps, these things that are only possible through Bitcoin. And I think these are really going to become the killer use cases for the Bitcoin network. Yeah, so I think that that's really what I want to emphasize with this, is that a lot of the use cases that people emphasize with Bitcoin, again, it compares it to an existing technology. So how does Bitcoin compare to credit cards? How does Bitcoin compare to fiat currency? That's really not the way to think about it. The way to think about it is what can Bitcoin enable that previously could not exist? These are the real killer use cases. This is what the industry is being built around. This is why venture capitalists have put $600 million into Bitcoin companies just in the past 3 years. Okay, so Coinbase. Okay, so I just want to talk about, for the entrepreneurs in the audience, what it means to build a company in an emerging space, and also how we fit into the ecosystem. So Coinbase was founded less than 3 years ago, in 2012, by Brian Armstrong and Fred Ersom, two great friends of mine. So we've since raised seed round Series A, Series B, Series C for a total of over $100 million. We have 2.6 million wallets, 38,000 merchants, and 7,000 apps built using our API. So this isn't the Bitcoin API, but rather Coinbase's API that harnesses our platform. So with me getting involved in Coinbase, so I was I was surveying the Bitcoin space a lot when I graduated from school in May 2012. And the companies I saw didn't have the vision I wanted for what Bitcoin could be. Many of them were, in my mind, trying to kind of make a quick buck. If you look back at the companies that existed at that time, none of them exist anymore. They've mostly all either gone bankrupt or gotten hacked or been shut down by a regulatory agency or by a bank. So I'm happy that I waited and was searching around for a long time for the right Bitcoin company. It turned out to be Coinbase, and I was Coinbase user about number 30. So I was right there when it kind of started and was keeping a close eye on it. I was actually extremely skeptical of the centralized wallet model which Coinbase uses, which is basically that we hold your Bitcoin for you rather than you holding your Bitcoin by default. We have an option called a multi-signature vault. It's a little complicated. That's how we can kind of share control, but at the end of the day, we have no ability to access your funds. But our default wallet is something where we control the keys that access your Bitcoin. I was extremely skeptical of this model because I had lost Bitcoin this way, and I knew that it was very, very vulnerable to security exploits, right? So one screw up and all the Bitcoin is gone. This is kind of what happened with Mt. Gox. I can talk a lot about how we prevent that, though. Okay, so I'll start with the kind of front end and then maybe go to the back end a little bit on how we protect Bitcoin. So first off, we have a wallet and vault. So this is kind of what I just said, I guess, but it's a way to store Bitcoin. So it uses emails and soon to use phone numbers so that you don't need to worry about Bitcoin addresses, which are cryptographic hashes that are very complicated. So this is much in the same way an IP address, which is like four sets of numbers separated by periods, are kind of obfuscated from the end user through URLs. So Coinbase.com, really what you're pinging is an IP address, but it's kind of easier to remember Coinbase.com. So this is much in the same way that we're trying to obscure Bitcoin addresses and the underlying infrastructure from the end user so they can just take advantage of all the payment efficiencies of Bitcoin without having to understand how it actually works in the back end. So we also have a buy, sell, and exchange service. This is one of the big things that we were able to do first before anyone else. You can buy Bitcoin with a bank account. So this sounds trivial. This sounds like, yeah, isn't that the first thing that you would do in Bitcoin? It took until 2012 for someone to build that. So it's actually not easy at all. What it means is you need to hook into the existing ACH, Automated Clearinghouse Bank Transfer protocol. You need to have a banking relationship that feels comfortable with what you're doing. You need to have a compliance program, anti-money laundering, know your customer programs. And on top of that, one of the biggest barriers to entry is you need to deal with fraud. So again, this is stolen bank accounts. So this is one of the things I specialize in Coinbase. The chargeback window for an ACH transfer is 60 days. What this means is when you authorize someone to debit your account, you can for 60 days call your bank and for whatever reason say, actually, I don't want to do that, and you can pull back the payment. Bitcoin does not work like this. Bitcoin, once I send it to you, it's yours. Needless to say, huge target for fraud. So anytime someone has a stolen bank account, they can go buy Bitcoin and essentially turn that money in that stolen bank account into Bitcoin. Chargebacks come through. The end user doesn't lose Bitcoin, doesn't lose any money. The bank doesn't lose any money. It's Coinbase that loses the money. So every e-commerce business sees fraud. We are particularly a target for fraud, but have very, very smart mechanisms. This is a completely different talk that I'm not going to get into. We have very, very smart mechanisms for preventing fraud. It's one of the big reasons we were able to launch this ACH transfer for Bitcoin service while other people weren't able to. So we recently launched the exchange too. You can see a screenshot of that in the lower right corner. So this exchange is a, again, it's kind of an API. It's designed for somewhat kind of high frequency traders or traders using large amounts of money. So this is, there's a user interface there that you can see, but in reality, most of the people using this exchange are trying to use it. Oh, shoot. Thank you. They're trying to use it with large amounts of Bitcoin and dollars. So this is pretty huge because it's the first real regulated exchange in the United States. Most of the existing exchanges have been in places like Slovenia or Russia, and have existed in slightly gray markets where they didn't have to obey US-based anti-money laundering or customer type laws. So we are fully compliant with those, and it's one of the big breakthroughs. So a lot of the exchange volume has moved to us because we're a more kind of legitimate player. So merchant tools, this is pretty simple. It's a way that merchants can accept Bitcoin and cash it out into dollars. So it's kind of just a payment gateway interface, right? So whenever you pay for something online, there's kind of this interface to enter your credit card number and execute the payment. In the background, a lot of weird stuff's happening, but to the end user, it's pretty simple. That's kind of what we're doing there. And then finally, something I'm really excited about is the API platform. So again, without explaining too much what an API is, it basically allows developers to interact with the really, really hard infrastructure that we've built. So it's really, really, really hard to build a Bitcoin wallet and an exchange and these merchant tools and all the complications that come with that from a security and a regulatory perspective. This allows developers to kind of build applications on top of our service that take advantage of those things that we've built without having to build them themselves. So a lot of cool applications are coming out, you know, every day using our API, some of them payment related, some of them not. But we want to create an open kind of environment for anyone to interact with our API so that anyone can build interesting applications that use Bitcoin, the Bitcoin protocol, in unique and fascinating ways without having to rebuild all of the infrastructure we've built. So one of the big things that takes advantage of is our storage of Bitcoin. And this is a little bit of the back end that I didn't put on here, but I'll explain it very briefly. So the way we store Bitcoin is, it's called cold storage. This is kind of the industry term for it. It means that you store the Bitcoin offline on a computer that doesn't touch the internet. So we take these keys that have sensitive, very, very sensitive information. It's basically just a string of ones and zeros that are excruciating, like, again, impossible to guess, even if you have every computer in the world. So we have these keys and we take them offline. We split it, so we shard the key into multiple pieces. We encrypt those keys and we geographically distribute the location of those keys. So what this means is no employee at Coinbase has access to that cold storage. You actually need multiple signers in order to recreate this key. And you'd need to gain access to multiple different geographic locations and people in order to regain access to this cold storage. So sometimes when people are pulling Bitcoin off the platform and the Bitcoin that's stored on the server, that's about 2% of our Bitcoin. About 98% is stored in this cold storage offline. We sometimes have to refill Bitcoin from cold storage to the hot wallet, so to speak, which is stored on the server. And that sometimes could require people flying around the world and meeting at bank vaults and all sorts of things like that. But this is one of the reasons that we're very secure. And I can go into way more detail on our security mechanisms and why we keep Bitcoin safe, and it's one of the most important things that we do. Well, it's the most important thing that we do. Okay, so opportunity in the Bitcoin space. So this is kind of a broad metaphor, but I want you to, oh yes, thank you. This is kind of a broad metaphor, but I want you to think about it and what it means. So basically how long it took for the internet to be created. So a lot of work was done on the protocol in the 1980s. This was done by computer scientists and geeks. Some of the infrastructure got built, so this is when computers were kind of going a little bit mainstream and people were building the first user interfaces to interact with this great network. And then I put the application layer there. You know, these dates are a little bit approximate, but that's about when the first web browser came out. So this is when the first users were able to interact with the internet without having to really know how it works or use a command line on a computer or anything like that. So with Bitcoin, I think we're going through a similar transformation where a lot of the innovation in the past has been at this protocol level. So you can look, and I mean, I put the end date of 2013. That's really a lie. A lot of these protocol innovations are still really exciting and still happening today. Things like Ethereum, Counterparty, Mastercoin, sidechains. There are ways that people are adding new features on top of Bitcoin to change the way it's mined, to change the way transactions are verified, to change the way the blockchain is recorded. It's all really exciting to me, but it's extremely, extremely geeky, and it's stuff that I don't want end users to ever have to worry about. So right now with Bitcoin, I think I would say we're transitioning more away from that protocol phase, though, and into the kind of infrastructure phase. So again, what this means is companies like Coinbase building ways to secure your Bitcoin. It seems trivial. It's like, okay, of course there should be services to just store Bitcoin. But if you look back 2 years ago, there really weren't any, and none of them were safe. Looking at ways to buy Bitcoin, again, you go back 2 years ago, it really was only Coinbase. So this has really only developed in the last year or two, this kind of infrastructure layer for basic tools for the Bitcoin economy to operate. I think we're still, I put a question mark there by application layer, because I think we're still looking for what really will be these killer applications like the web browser, right? It's very hard to, when you hear about the internet protocol, you're hearing about TCP/IP, right? The way that packets are transmitted through servers in the network. To imagine the Googles and Facebooks and Twitters of the future internet, right? People thought there wouldn't be video on the internet, right? And here's YouTube. So I think with Bitcoin, it's a similar thing where a lot of people, myself included, have a kind of gut instinct that there's going to be these incredible applications built on top of it. But I also can't always tell you what they are, just in the way that people in 1995 couldn't tell you about Facebook, right? It took 9 more years for Facebook to be developed after the internet. Now we look back, we think, oh, that was obvious. I can't believe no one thought to build that. It's like a social network, right? But I think a lot of that innovation with Bitcoin is going to happen as this infrastructure is completed, and we'll see the real use cases where average mainstream consumers are using Bitcoin every day, even if they don't realize they are, even if it's on the back end. So there's kind of two other things I wanted to mention. One is that kind of the fintech space right now is getting pretty big. So things like are coming out like Venmo, Apple Pay, Facebook Cash was recently released through Messenger. You can send money. Google Wallet. So those are all the kind of consumer ways to spend money from peer to peer. And a lot of people say, you know, how is Bitcoin going to compete with Apple Pay? This is a completely wrong question. So Apple Pay is a UI layer, right? All of the payment infrastructure is identical to what it always has been. It's just adding a kind of user interface that's really clean and pretty, and so you can transfer from phone to phone or from your phone to a merchant. So Bitcoin isn't really a UI layer innovation. It's really a protocol and infrastructure layer innovation. So you could have Bitcoin on Apple Pay, right? Apple Pay is not a payment protocol. It's more of just a user interface to send money. And there's a couple of B2B companies doing that too, Stripe and Braintree. Again, these are using just existing payment protocols. They're not really building anything new. So I think it's important in your mind to specify the difference between a user interface that's using existing payment rails versus real new technology that's actually building new payment rails, which is what Bitcoin is. Okay, and yeah, in 2 years, there's gonna be 5 billion internet-connected smartphones that can participate in the Bitcoin economy or cryptocurrency economy, and there's going to be 500 million bank accounts, so 1/10. Yeah, I think that kind of speaks for itself as far as the opportunity in the space. Okay, so this is where we look further into the future and the crystal ball gets a little bit foggier, and just bear with me if some of this sounds a little insane. Okay, so in the recent past, Bitcoin has been often used as a sort of e-gold, speculative investment, right? I want to store my wealth as Bitcoin, and I want to just hold onto that value. I want to speculate on that price. This is a good use case for Bitcoin because there's a limited supply, right? There will only ever be 21 million Bitcoin. So I get my little piece of the pie, and I know it won't be inflated away. Hypothetically, the price will go up over time as demand increases, and there I go, right? It's a good way to store money. But it's also this really efficient payment network. So what is it, right? How will it be used? And I think it's hard to know. I think that you might have different cryptocurrencies being used for different things. You might have, you know, side chains is kind of a development happening right now, which is, I'll skip down a little bit, that's the blockchains on blockchains, the fourth heading down. This is kind of a way to depend on the security of a single blockchain, but in order to build protocols on different blockchains. It gets pretty complicated, but that's going to have a lot of potential. Another question is, you know, will this replace, thank you very much. Another big question here is, will this replace ad and clickbait revenue, right? So right now, most of the way the internet is monetized is through banner ads, which is kind of insane. You'd think that there'd be a better way to do this. Well, there actually is. It's just being developed. Doesn't exist yet. So you can imagine a future where you pay kind of micropayments to access pages instead of paywalls. You kind of automatically in the browser are paying micropayments in order to access content on the internet. I think this could add a whole new business models and really replace a lot of the stuff out there that exists today. Another one is machine to machine. So think Internet of Things, right? So everything is becoming internet connected. From my thermostat to my car to my refrigerator to my suitcase, right? So all of these things are going to be able to interact on a payment protocol now in a programmatic fashion. So my suitcase could pay my refrigerator. I know that sounds really weird, but these are the types of things that are really going to be happening. So my car might pay a different car in order to get to the fast lane, right? In order to merge more quickly. Or my suitcase might pay the guy who moves my suitcase on the airplane or something like that. I mean, it just gets really weird. And it's hard to imagine what that will look like, but when you have a whole lot of internet-connected machines all operating on a unified payment protocol, there are a lot of possibilities there that are kind of fun to imagine. So the fifth one down here is huge. This one I mentioned a little bit before, and it's the decentralization of many centralized services. So services like Facebook, Twitter, Dropbox, and Gmail are all based on a trusted third party holding a huge amount of data in order to make a very clean end user experience. So a lot of these could be re-architected on the back end to use the blockchain and this public database that anyone can write data to. And it would be, you know, kind of equally secure, and it would all be run through these micropayments, and it would be perfectly efficient in the sense that there would be no Facebook, Twitter, or Dropbox, or Gmail taking profits on top of that, right? So again, it gets a little abstract, but basically any centralized service you can imagine, there are decentralized versions being built on the blockchain right now. That's a big idea for me. And then finally, distributed smart assets in a blockchain New York Stock Exchange. So right now you can IPO and distribute your shares on the blockchain. So this is what a smart asset is. The blockchain can hold payment data, or it can hold any other type of data. So I can say this specific Bitcoin is going to represent 100% of the shares in Olaf Corporation, and then I can distribute those shares on the blockchain. I don't need to go through any sort of regulatory agency to do that, nor do I need to go through a centralized trading service like the New York Stock Exchange or NASDAQ to distribute those shares. And then you can trade them in a completely peer-to-peer fashion with people on other continents, or through crowdfunding campaigns or anything else. So the future for me with this is fully distributed, fully encrypted, and it's going to be really, really exciting. And again, I think a lot of the innovation is going to happen when this UI layer gets built that is completely abstracted from the Bitcoin blockchain, how it works, or any of this confusing cryptography stuff. So the piece I want to leave you with before we get to a Q&A is, you know, what has it meant for Coinbase to emerge out of this space? And I think what I've learned is that there are three keys to a successful company, and it's being at the right time, at the right place, and executing, right? So I think Coinbase, the people that founded Coinbase and working as an early employee at Coinbase, we really saw that Bitcoin had this potential, and we saw that it had the potential right now, right? If Coinbase would have been founded 2 years earlier, it likely would not have succeeded. If it would have been founded 2 years later, it almost surely would not have succeeded. So being at that right time, at that right place, and then executing, right? So we haven't gotten hacked, and most every other Bitcoin company has gotten hacked. This is one of the big things. So that's what I want to leave you with, and I'm excited to answer all of your questions. I'm sure you have a ton of them. So thank you.
Thank you, Olaf. That was very interesting. Thank you for staying, and we've collected a lot of questions. I'm going to start with a couple of my own questions. And unfortunately, I have to start off by violating Olaf's what he told us about Bitcoin, to not compare it to existing material, but I have to do it to start off with, being an economist. One of the things I think that makes it hard for everyday people to use Bitcoin is that it's got no underlying value, and it fluctuates so wildly that no one would want to hold Bitcoin instead of another currency. And I know I'm comparing it. So how will that problem get solved?
Yep. So the volatility is huge. So this has actually been a problem for regular Bitcoin users since the beginning, right? So they make a bunch of money, they lose a bunch of money, and you don't know what's going to happen. So I think this is going to get solved in a couple ways. So one is stop thinking about Bitcoin as a currency and think about it more as a payment mechanism. So you can go from dollars to Bitcoin to yen, right? And Bitcoin can just be the payment piece, and it can exist for that just tiny, tiny, tiny window when you need to actually transfer the money. But it doesn't need to be actually stored as Bitcoin. So I think that this reduces a lot of the volatility, because on both ends you're basically dealing with state-based fiat currencies, and that Bitcoin's really just the payment mechanism. Again, as I kind of mentioned in the talk, advanced trading features really don't exist on top of Bitcoin. So once there's more liquidity in the market and things like derivatives available to those people, I think that it's going to really reduce the amount of kind of basement speculators in the Bitcoin market, which it has historically been filled with.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to ask a sort of a silly question, but you kept telling the audience that you can lose a Bitcoin.
Oh, yeah.
So how do you lose a Bitcoin, just in simple terms?
Yep. So again, in simple terms, Bitcoin is stored essentially as a string, right? So strings of ones and zeros. If someone else gains access to that string, they steal your Bitcoin. If you somehow lose that string, the Bitcoin is gone. So no one gets it. It's just gone forever. It's like if I burned a $20 bill. That's essentially how people lose Bitcoin.
Okay. Before we get to all these questions, can you tell us one of your greatest successes at Coinbase and one of your greatest failures?
Yep. Absolutely. Let me think. I'll start with the success. So we had this really, really big problem with customer support. So this is when Coinbase was, I think, about 5 employees. We had 250,000 users, and I was the only person covering customer support. So needless to say, I was receiving a ton of emails, and there was no time to answer them for 250,000 people. So our average response time was like over 100 hours to just hear back from us, which is really not good, right, for a financial company. So we were trying to hire more people on the customer support team, but we quickly realized we need a whole team of people. We didn't just need like one person. And the company was only 5 people, right? So if we're going to hire 5 customer support people, it was going to be kind of weird to have that proportion of the whole company be customer support. And at the same time, it was going to be really hard to find those 5 really, really top-notch, all-star people like in the next week. So instead we decided, okay, let's try a shot at building a remote team. So we'll build it geographically distributed. Everyone will work from their home. So how do we find these people though, right, if they're not in San Francisco? So what we did, I wrote a Bitcoin test. Think of it like SAT for Bitcoin. And I posted it on some prominent Bitcoin forums. And we had an astounding turnout on this test. It got a lot of traction. A lot of people just wanted to see if they could pass it, right? They maybe weren't even interested in the job, but it got a lot of hype. We had something like 200 people take the test in like 48 hours. So all the people that got perfect scores, of which there were just a handful, I tried to make it as difficult as possible. I basically called them on the phone, and in about 3 months, we had a team of 40 people geographically distributed around the entire world. So we still have this team. They're some of the smartest Bitcoin people around. They know so much about the protocol, and they've learned a lot about how Coinbase operates. So it's been just kind of a pleasure to have this whole team be really global. So we have people in Australia, Saigon, Paris, Germany, like Berlin in Germany. We have people in London, Italy, Canada, coast to coast in the United States. It's really geographically distributed. So that's probably the big success. I would say the big failure is it's not tackling the fraud problem as quickly as we could have. I'll leave that. It's a little bit more detailed and maybe proprietary knowledge, but basically fraud is something that, you know, when you're worrying about building a company and scaling it really, really quickly and you're using venture capital funds, you're not often so worried about your bottom line and your burn rate, right? Because you're just trying to scale. You're not really trying to make money at that point. So now we have fraud really well controlled, but at the early, early days of the company, we were so worried about growing fast that we kind of let it spiral a little bit out of control, but now fully in control.
Okay, thank you. What advice would you give to students or young people in general? You're pretty young yourself. About starting a business. Just quick advice.
It's extremely difficult. Make sure you know what you're getting into. You know, it's every day is going to be a grind. It's going to be very, very hard. And there are going to be these really dark moments where you're not sure it's going to work. Where when you go home to tell your family, what do? You say, I work on this thing that no one cares about. And it is, it's hard. There's kind of this social pressure to have it be validated, and it's not going to happen overnight. And you might not be making any money, right? You might be building this in your garage and paying yourself from a dwindling bank account. So I guess what I'd say is it takes a lot of grit, but that every single day, assuming the business is successful, gets easier. So if it's getting harder and harder for years, it's probably not the right business. If it's getting easier though, it probably is. And again, I think it's really important if you're building a technology business to really think about, a lot of people are looking at building a business and where do you have specific knowledge that other people don't about what's possible, right? So if you don't know anything about payments and you try to start a payments company, you're going to have a hard time. But if you know a lot about payments, and for some reason you think you know some special things about payments that most people don't, you probably have a good advantage there. So I would say find the most obscure thing you can that other people aren't going to know about, but you're going to have a special knowledge set for, and then get ready for the grind and have some serious grit because it's not easy.
Okay, thank you. So let's start with the questions from the audience. I've picked a few here. One person said, you said Apple Pay and Coinbase are two completely different things, but at the end of the day, it goes back to the customers. What advantage does Coinbase offer more than other online transaction apps?
Yeah, great question. So again, I think it's the things that are kind of native to Bitcoin. So things like cross-border payments and micropayments. This is really where we're trying to push traction right now. Another big piece, again, is the permissionless innovation. So anyone can use our API or just the Bitcoin protocol to build the different kinds of applications so that people can gain the advantages of the Bitcoin protocol without having to worry about mining or how the network operates. So again, I think the main thing is to separate out the payment rails from the user interface of those rails. So the web now has a really great interface. It didn't used to, but the rails haven't really changed. Much in the way that, you know, Bitcoin is it's a completely different, it's a new payment rail. So the interface kind of has to catch up while we still build those rails.
Thank you. I can see a lot of uses for micropayments, but why couldn't banks or credit card companies come up with their systems without requiring the Bitcoin?
So I'm assuming that means why can't they enable micropayments using some sort of proprietary infrastructure that's not Bitcoin? This is where Bitcoin is truly a technological breakthrough in distributed encrypted protocols that people have been working on for decades. So public key cryptography was created in 1976, and the internet was really getting built again late 80s, early 90s. And people from the get-go were thinking a lot about digital cash. And it's a very, very hard problem. And Bitcoin, the protocol, actually solved this incredibly difficult problem called the Byzantine Generals problem. And it's how to build trust in an untrusted network where you don't trust any specific individual peer. So Bitcoin was a legitimate technological breakthrough in a way that had never existed before. For banks or credit card companies to build such a network, they would have to come up with a kind of similar technological breakthrough. There are basic things about the credit card networks and bank networks that have these embedded costs that just frankly cannot compete with the efficiencies of Bitcoin.
Thank you.
If there will only be 21 million Bitcoins, how can Bitcoin become mainstream? How will it be valued?
So I think an important thing to keep in mind is that so the Bitcoin blockchain will only have 21 million Bitcoin. But again, cryptocurrency and blockchains in general have no such rule. So whether the 21 million Bitcoin, whether that will be a defining characteristic of cryptocurrencies, I think is kind of secondary. Does that make sense? That it's not something that's inevitable, right, in the Bitcoin blockchain. The Bitcoin blockchain can always fork and the protocol rules can change depending on what the miners want to do. And also new cryptocurrencies can come out. So, but given all that, I think that for a long time it's not going to matter. The 21 million Bitcoin cap won't be reached until the year 2140, which is a pretty far length off. So I think we have many, many, many years where there's going to be a kind of normal monetary supply increase in Bitcoin. Maybe a couple decades, and I don't want to try to predict out what's going to happen beyond that. But yeah, I think you have a good point, basically, that there could be kind of monetary policy problems with there being that much Bitcoin, or sorry, a limited cap on the number of Bitcoin. But at the same time, I wouldn't view it as replacing traditional fiat currencies or anything like that, becoming the whole pie, but rather just a piece of it, just one payment rail. So if you're using it just for payments, I don't think that's necessarily a big problem. If you're using it as this kind of e-gold, that might be exactly what you're looking for. If it was trying to be its own totally wholesome currency that could replace a fiat currency, this might be a problem, definitely.
Thanks. You mentioned cryptocurrencies, and this question says, why did Bitcoin succeed and not other cryptocurrencies?
Bitcoin was first. That's basically it, honestly. Network effects. Satoshi Nakamoto, whoever he or she or they were, really thought it out. And I have this book that's everything Satoshi Nakamoto ever wrote on these forums. And he or she addressed all of the scaling problems that Bitcoin has run into in the initial protocol release. I don't know how they envisioned all of these things happening, but they really did. It's first, and there were network effects, and it was architected nearly perfectly from the beginning.
Why is there a fixed cap to the maximum number of Bitcoins?
I think Satoshi Nakamoto knew that he needed people to enter the economy when there were no network effects, right? If you're Bitcoin user number one, what's the point? There really isn't one. So I think a lot of the way he kind of branded this public database blockchain technology was as e-gold, so to speak. So he said, there's gonna be a cap, and you all want some because someday it'll be worth a lot. And this speculative investing has been a great way to bootstrap interest in the Bitcoin economy. Most of the reason any of us have read about Bitcoin is because the price has gone up, and the media has really latched onto that. So I think that it was actually a really smart bootstrapping mechanism to say there's going to be a limited supply, and that's going to make it kind of interesting for investors to get involved with, because if demand goes up, supply doesn't go up, price goes up, right? I make money. I think that, he may have also had views where he wanted it to be a fixed supply for monetary policy reasons or something like that, but hard to say.
Thank you. There's two questions that are similar, so I'll read one and then add on to the other one. What's to prevent some jerk from just swooping up all the available bitcoins and rendering the whole thing worthless? Related to that is, how great is the danger of Bitcoin being hacked? What's to say that another event like the thing that happened already.
Mount Gox, yeah.
What's it called?
Mount Gox.
Mount Gox won't occur.
Yep. Okay, so important to separate out two things. One is the Bitcoin protocol, one is services and products built on top of the Bitcoin protocol. So The Bitcoin protocol can't be hacked because it's cryptographically secure, and again, thousands of security researchers have audited the code, and anyone can view it on GitHub, and it's totally open source. So Bitcoin, you can't really steal the Bitcoin network. It's kind of like saying, why can't you just hack the internet? You can't, because it works in such a way that it's not possible. So as far as actual Bitcoin services and companies built on top of the protocol, absolutely there will continue to be security breaches because people aren't securing Bitcoin properly. But you know, over time, I think that industry standards, kind of like PCI compliance for storing credit card numbers, will be created, and industry trade groups will come up with standardized ways to store Bitcoin that are much safer. So these are some of the things Coinbase is building today and kind of pioneering, blazing the trail for a lot of these security mechanisms.
Thank you.
How can we, or one, invest in Bitcoin to take advantage as a potential investor?
You can sign up on Coinbase.com and go buy Bitcoin with your bank account. If you don't have a bank account, it's a little bit harder, but there are all sorts of people around the world who are willing to trade cash for Bitcoin or other types of assets for Bitcoin. That's probably, Coinbase.com is probably your best bet if you're in America.
Okay.
Let's skip this one. How will Bitcoin deal with the opposition from banking and something else, but maybe the banking industry?
Mm-hmm. So again, I don't really view Bitcoin as competing with banking per se. So I think, you know, banks have actually been really interested to learn about Bitcoin for their own internal ledgers. So if banks could use Bitcoin to improve clearing speeds on things like automated clearinghouse or credit card payments, that would actually be huge for banks, right? So there's really no, I wouldn't view it as against. That's a little bit of a narrow view, but how will they deal with it? I do think that over the next decade, financial institutions will need to have a sort of Bitcoin plan, much in the way that a lot of companies in the 90s needed a sort of internet strategy, right? And if you don't have one, you're going to get left in the dust just because of the payment efficiencies. So I don't really view it as an against thing, but I do think people need to absorb it and innovate, or they will be left behind a little bit.
Thank you. What would you say to people who say that the IRS's decision that to treat virtual currencies as personal property makes it not fungible and therefore not a currency?
So to clarify for those that aren't aware, the IRS released guidelines saying that Bitcoin would not be treated as a currency like dollars or pesos are, but rather as property like a stock or share of Apple, say, is. I don't think, you know, it's really a taxation issue. I don't think it really affects fungibility. So fungibility being, you know, how much is it possible for one Bitcoin to be indistinguishable from other Bitcoin, right? So I have one $20 bill, it's just as much value as any other $20 bill. So I don't think it really affects that. It is a little bit complicated for taxation because every time I do a large Bitcoin transaction, right, that's a kind of taxable event, much in the same way if I sold stock, that's a taxable event. So yeah, I think the IRS wanted to put out guidelines quickly, and I think this was kind of the safe guidelines for them to put out. I wouldn't be surprised if over time whole new guidelines come out that treat Bitcoin as a kind of unique asset, because again, this is them grappling with what is this, and well, is it currency or property? The reality is that it's kind of neither, so let's just pick one. So I don't think it's really a problem other than it creates kind of taxable liabilities for every single Bitcoin transaction, which on tax day, I can tell you, having gotten my salary in Bitcoin for the last 2 years, is complicated.
Thank you. Can you expand on what a decentralized service, i.e. Facebook Gmail, would look like front and back end? Someone wants to start a company, I think.
Okay, yeah. Okay, awesome. So the back end stuff is way more important. User interface can always get better and better. It's really the back end architecture that matters in this case. So a lot of this is encrypted storage on a bunch of different devices. So I dedicate 10 gigabytes of my computer's storage to store encrypted data for other users, right? So I might be storing a tiny piece of your Facebook profile or like one of your photos on my drive. It's fully encrypted, so I can't access it, but I'm storing it instead of Facebook storing it on their servers. Then when you ping to access that photo, it will be redundantly stored. So if my computer's shut, right, you can still access it from somebody else who has it open. So through this kind of distributed encrypted network, I know this is a little bit of a broad answer, I know, but through distributed encrypted networks, you can basically distribute the database storage and content of normal web applications such that I can access files without having to go to a centralized party. I can instead get that data from a number of different people. This is similar to the way the torrent protocol works. So with torrent files, I'm actually downloading from potentially thousands of different people simultaneously, tiny, tiny little bits of the entire file. So you can imagine a future where your Dropbox files or your Facebook files or anything are stored in such a mechanism using kind of torrent protocol and encrypted storage on different drives, on different hard drives. Huge network effects to overcome if you're thinking about starting that company. Also, to the end user, they might not see a lot of advantages other than there not being ads, suppose it's Facebook. And they might have to pay money in order to support the nodes who are storing this encrypted data. So I think there are huge complications. If you want to start that company, though, come talk to me afterwards.
Okay, great. These are simple questions, but I've received two, so I thought maybe you can give a simple example. One person said, how do you personally use Bitcoin today? The other person said, how do we buy Bitcoin using US dollars? And once I have a Bitcoin, how do I use it to pay for things?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so to buy it in US dollars, again, you can buy it with cash by meeting someone, you can buy it with a bank transfer, you can buy it with a credit card, all sorts of different ways that you would normally pay for things, you can buy Bitcoin. As far as using Bitcoin, for me personally, I pay my rent in Bitcoin and I pay my friends in Bitcoin when I owe them things. So I kind of use it as like a peer-to-peer transfer of funds. That's primarily in my day-to-day life, the number one way I use Bitcoin. I also buy stuff online with Bitcoin. So again, there's a lot of big merchants that take Bitcoin online these days. There's a lot of like high-end electronics people that take Bitcoin, and I'm a huge geek. So it works for me. A lot of people aren't gonna find a ton of things that they want that they can buy online with Bitcoin. But I think right now, the main thing for, again, everyday first world users who already have access to traditional payment mechanisms like bank accounts and credit cards, it's gonna be mostly useful in peer-to-peer transfers. But I think it's more useful for people that don't have access to bank accounts, credit cards, things like that.
Okay, so let me just follow up on that. So if I wanted to go buy something, I would take my dollars, and where would I go buy the Bitcoin?
How do you have your dollars?
I have it in a bank. I have it
in a bank.
Yeah.
I don't mean you literally go to Coinbase. I know that's kind of a plug.
Okay,
for Coinbase,
so but one way is I go to Coinbase, get the Bitcoin, and I have an account there. And then I can go online to some website, buy it, and Coinbase will transfer it.
Yes, exactly right.
Okay.
Exactly right.
Okay. What do we have next? We're almost done. We have. I'll give it two last questions. One question. Let's see. There's a lot of questions about the stability. I'll ask it. But when would Bitcoin be able to reduce its volatility to make it accessible to everyday users? How long will it take for Bitcoin to be stable in price value?
Okay, so how long? I don't really know. I know that it's trending towards stability. When I got involved with Bitcoin, it was absolutely insane. So as an example, when I first got into Bitcoin and I wired a lot of money to Japan, it felt like a lot at the time. Again, I didn't have a lot of money. Wired that to Japan. To buy some Bitcoin, it immediately lost 80% of its value, like in the next 50 days or something like that. It used to be a lot more intense than it is, so I think it's trending towards stability. It really has to do with when these financial tools and platforms are going to get built such that
larger pools of capital from mainstream Forex traders can actually participate in the Bitcoin market. And most of the time, they don't want to just buy and sell. They want to use derivatives. And they need fast tools, right? So it needs to be built like into terminals and things like that. So once we have it being traded on the New York Stock Exchange or NASDAQ, then I think we're going to see a lot more stability because there's large capital in the market. On top of that, though, Bitcoin is slowly shifting away from a speculative asset and more towards a payment network as this infrastructure gets built. So as people use it more and more for payments and less for speculation, I think that's also going to reduce volatility. I wish I could tell you the exact timeline on these things, but it's kind of what Coinbase is building right now. So I think, you know, until volatility is not really a hot topic, I'd give it like 3 years, something like that.
And when you say move to a payment mechanism, it's literally the situation where I take $10,000, convert it to Bitcoin, send it over to Japan, convert it to yen, and I buy something.
Yep.
So it's a maybe I hold it for a day or so.
Hold it for a second.
Second, okay.
Yep.
Okay, last question, and then we'll end. This is kind of an interesting question, maybe a fun question. This person wrote, what do you think of BitReserve? And would you hold Bitcoin in other currencies like gold or oil?
Okay, so for those that aren't familiar, BitReserve is a website where you can store Bitcoin, right? So you have Bitcoin there, but you can store it as other assets. So you send them Bitcoin, but then you can store it as dollars. Okay, so this kind of reduces the volatility. It gets a little bit both into useful applications on top of the blockchain, so they can kind of reduce volatility on your behalf, but still give you all the benefits that the Bitcoin payment network offers. Simultaneously, there's a little bit of smart contract type stuff going on there. So by smart contract, I mean trading other assets on the blockchain. So I think BitReserve, I'm not positive, but I think they only support a few mainstream fiat currencies like dollars or pesos or something like that, but there's no reason they couldn't also have your Bitcoin stored as oil or stored as gold and basically take advantage of all these payment mechanisms, the payment infrastructure built on Bitcoin that's really efficient, but actually have the underlying asset and the price be based on oil or gold or dollars or something like that. So I actually really like BitReserve because I think they are kind of pushing forward this idea of Bitcoin as payment mechanism, not Bitcoin as a speculative investment.
Okay, well, thank you everyone for coming. Thank you, Olaf.
Yep, thank you. Thank you.